Chapter 5, The Cradle of the Human Race, Human Origins. Africa has a key role in the early history of humanity. It was, in fact, the cradle of the human race. Diodorus Siculus, an outstanding Greek historian of antiquity, wrote an encyclopedic work on world history in the 1st century BC. These volumes demonstrate the state of historical knowledge in Diodorus's time. We have extracted the following account of human origins. Now the Ethiopians, i.e. Africans, as historians relate, were the first of all men, and the proofs of this statement they say are manifest. For that they did not come into their land as immigrants from abroad, but were natives of it, and so justly bear the name of Autochthones, i.e. sprung from the soil itself is. They maintain, conceded by practically all men, furthermore, that those who dwell beneath the noonday sun were, in all likelihood, the first to be generated by the earth, is clear to all, since inasmuch as it was the warmth of the sun which, the generation of the universe, dried up the earth when it was still wet and impregnated it with life, it is reasonable to suppose that the region which was nearest to the sun was the first to bring forth living creatures. Charles Darwin, the father of natural selection theory, wrote The Descent of Man. This 1871 work contained the first ever attempt to apply natural selection theories to the origin of humanity. One of the topics Darwin discussed was on the birthplace and antiquity of man. This section begins as follows. We are naturally led to inquire, where was the birthplace of man? In each great region of the world, the living mammals are closely related to the extinct species of the same region. It is therefore probable that Africa was formerly inhabited by extinct apes closely related to the gorilla and chimpanzee. And as these two species are now man's nearest allies, it is somewhat more probable that our early progenitors lived on African continent than elsewhere. The erudite Albert Churchward, author of The Masterly Signs and Symbols of Primordial Man, developed a theory on the origin and evolution of humanity and culture in 1910. The research of this great English scholar advanced the theories of Darwin and also those of his mentor, Gerald Massey. Research has led us to bring forward such evidence, as furnished by the records and monuments of the country or nations of the world, where we find the same myths and legends, the same sacred ceremonies and identical religious beliefs, which, when correctly interpreted, proves that only one conclusion can be definitely arrived at, which we have set forth in this work. The first or Paleolithic man was the pygmy, who was evolved in Central Africa at the sources of the Nile or Nile Valley, and that from here all originated and were carried throughout the world. In 1961, Robert Ardrey, an American writer, wrote an important popular work on evolution called African Genesis. This book opens with a wonderful poetic introduction where we are assured that, not in innocence and not in Asia, was mankind born. The home of our fathers was that African highland reaching north from the Cape to the lakes of the Nile. Here we came about, slowly, ever so slowly, on a sky-swept savanna glowing with menace. The archaeological evidence broadly supports the position taken by Diodorus, Darwin, Churchward, and Ardrey. The oldest known skeletal remains of anatomically modern humanity, Homo sapiens sapiens, were excavated at four sites in Africa. Human remains were discovered at Omo in Ethiopia that were dated at 195,000 years old. Skeletons have also been found at Laetoli in Tanzania, Klazi's River Mouth in South Africa, and Border Cave in South Africa. These finds have been dated at between 130,000 and 110,000 years old. The oldest Homo sapiens sapiens remains excavated in Asia were dated at 95,000 years old. The oldest found in Europe were dated at 39,000 years old. Finally, the oldest found in Australasia were dated at 32,000 years old, though it is believable that humans have inhabited that continent for 70,000 years. Human skeletons outside Africa are, therefore, much younger than the oldest African finds. This evidence supports the notion that humanity originated in Africa and gradually spread out over the globe. All of the remains so far discussed, including the Asian, the European, and the Australasian finds, were of Negroid type. The oldest known skeletons remains found in both southern France and the Caucasus region of Russia. These finds, some of which are Caucasians or at least ancestors of Caucasians, have been dated at 20,000 years old. The oldest known remains of the Mongolian type, Chinese, Japanese, Malaysian, etc., are younger still. Professor Rebecca Kahn and her colleagues at the University of Berkeley, California, conducted a pioneering work with mitochondrial DNA. Their findings, published in 1987 edition of Nature magazine, suggested that all modern humans have lineage traceable to a single female ancestor. Her theory is an example of monogenesis, the idea that all human groups are descended from the same parent population. Dr. Kan's article was entitled Mitochondrial DNA and Human Evolution. In the abstract to this valuable paper, we read the following. Mitochondrial DNAs from 147 people drawn from 5 geographic populations have been analyzed by restriction mapping. All these mitochondrial DNAs stem from one woman who is postulated to have lived about 200,000 years ago, probably in Africa. Professor Kan drew conclusions on how her team's findings should be interpreted. We infer that Africa is a likely source of the human mitochondrial gene pool. Our tentative interpretation fits with one view of the fossil record, that the transformation of archaic to anatomically modern forms of Homo sapiens, i.e. Homo sapiens sapiens, occurred first in Africa, and that all present-day humans are descendants of that African population. Newsweek, the widely read weekly journal, did much to popularize the new mitochondrial DNA research from the University of Berkeley. Concerning the African ancestress, they inform us that scientists are calling her Eve, but reluctantly. The name evokes too many wrong images, the weak-willed figure in Genesis, the milk-skinned beauty in Renaissance art, the luxury gardener in Paradise Lost, who was all softness and meek surrender, and waist-length gold tresses. The scientist's Eve, subject of one of the most provocative anthropological theories in a decade, was more likely a dark-haired, black-skinned woman roaming a hot savanna in search of food. In Britain, the well-established conservative newspaper Daily Mail brought these research findings to the attention of their readership. They also reviewed River Out of Eden, a book on the topic by Oxford University Professor Richard Dawkins. Just imagine this. You, me, and every man, woman, and child who walks the earth is descended from the same African woman. Genesis gave us a version of the story with the Garden of Eden, as do most religions and tribal legends. But what if the existence of a shared ancestral mother could be scientifically proven? A matter of fact, rather than faith. In his new book, River Out of the Eden, the zoologist Richard Dawkins, author of The Selfish Gene, sets out to achieve this mind-boggling goal. His compelling conclusions are rooted in Darwin's theory of natural selection. Dawkins does not just content himself with taking us step-by-step back to our common ancestor. He goes much further, giving her an identity. She was a black woman who lived a quarter of a million years ago, and we can trace our way back to her only through the female line. It has been suggested that Homo sapiens sapiens evolved from earlier hominid types in East Africa over an estimated period of 5 million years. New research is already starting to challenge this position. Some claim that hominid fossils dating back 7 million years have been found in the Sahara. The reader must therefore be aware that new finds will quickly make the archaeological details presented in this chapter out of date. In addition, each new find will trigger debates about whether the hominid represented is really a human ancestor or an evolutionary dead end. Whichever be the case, the main point is still inescapable. Humanity is of African origin, and the ancestors of humanity are also of African origin. Only the details will change as new discoveries are made and discussed. The oldest ancestral type of humanity is generally thought to have the Australopithecus remedus, who lived at least 4.4 million years ago. They were typically around 4 feet 6 inches in height. They walked upright and were robust in appearance. Unable to make stone tools, they probably used sticks and branches instead. Their diet was mainly vegetarian, though they may have scavenged for meat and also ate small animals. Australopithecus afarensis, who flourished about 4 million years ago, is said to have evolved from the Ramidus type. They were fully bipedal, of small stature, and had small skulls with a size of around 480 cc. This type of hominid was in turn superseded by another Australopithecan type, but the details are hazy. The possible candidates for succession were lightly built Australopithecus africanus, the massive and heavy-featured Authoropithecus robustus, or the hyper-robust Authoropithecus boci. In general, all of the Australopithecan types were short in stature, dark or black-colored, and were relatively hairless. Their culture flourished from 5 million until 2 million years ago in East and Southern Africa. None of their remains have been found outside of this continent. They were forager scavengers and used sticks and stones as tools. By 1 million years ago, the Australopithecans had died out entirely. The Homo family succeeded the Australopithecans possibly 2.5 million years ago. Homo habilis was the first of the prehumans to make tools. Dr. Herritt continues, the tools belong to what we call the Olduwan industry, Industry, as used by archaeologists of early humans, refers to the kit of tools and the tool-making techniques used by a particular human population. This toolkit was rudimentary. It consisted simply of sharp flakes broken off of stones by striking them with other stones. The sharp flakes, however, could efficiently cut and skin even thick-skinned animals, and the making of all-to-one tools would have greatly facilitated the meat-collecting capabilities of their makers. Homo habilis was typically dark-colored, short of stature, and had a skull capacity of 600 to 800 cc. They existed for over a million years in East Africa alongside the later Australopithecans. Moreover, like the Australopithecans, there is no evidence that this species had ever left Africa. Homo habilis finally died out around 1.6 million years ago. Homo erectus became the next species to emerge about 1.7 million years ago. This was the first of the pre-humans to travel away from Africa. Skeletons of them were found in Asia, such as Java man and Peking man. Members of this species were much closer in appearance to modern humans. The tallest of them stood 6 feet tall. In appearance, they were dark-colored and their skulls were 800 to 1200 cc in size. Though not as large as modern human skulls, there is some overlap in size with the smaller modern skulls. The main difference was that Homo erectus skulls were lower, flatter, and with more pronounced brow ridges. Of their culture, they invented fire and were highly proficient as toolmakers. They are also thought to have been ancestors of modern human type that succeeded them about 195,000 years ago or 200,000 years ago, according to the DNA evidence. The Caucasian people of Europe originated about 20,000 years ago. There were descendants of African migrants to Europe who entered the continent 39,000 years ago. These migrants, called Grimaldis or Cro-Magnons in the literature, left an important cultural impact known as the Aurignacian culture. Mr. LeGrand Clegg, a well-known contributor to the Journal of African Civilizations, informs us of the importance of the African migration. One can state without exaggeration that the Grimaldis, referring to early Africans, brought civilization. Such as it was, from prehistoric Africa to prehistoric Europe, their invention of sculpting and their general contribution to the field of art were universally recognized by scientists until the modern Grimaldi blackout, which occurred because of the need of some Western authorities to deny the area over which Negroids were scattered on the face of the globe. In addition to their invention of pendants, stone implements, certain styles of dress, an advanced symbol system, and perhaps even musical instruments, the Grimaldis were undoubtedly the first Homo sapiens to bury their dead, and they may have introduced to the world the use of the bow. Art historian H.G. Spearing of Oxford University commented upon the early art from Europe. He confirms that nearly all of the persons depicted were similar to the Bushmen and Hottentots. These are the Negro inhabitants of the southwestern Africa who were more correctly called Kojin. It is unfortunate, laments Mr. Spearing, that the head of figure 12 is missing, for it might have shown what race was represented. The shape of the body indicates a better race than most of the other statuettes, some of which are so fat that they almost seem to represent a stedopigeous, i.e. large buttock race like the Bushmen or Hottentots. Europe, during this period, however, was in an ice age. A 1-mile-thick block of ice that extended across southern Russia, Poland, northern Germany, and southern England covered much of the continent. During this period, it was a great evolutionary disadvantage to be dark-skinned. Not only is dark skin more prone to frostbite and other forms of cold injury, dark skin also protects the skin from ultraviolet light. Sunlight, a great source of ultraviolet light, can prove injurious to skin and cause cancers in extreme cases. Sunlight is, however, a great source of vitamin D, which is useful for the proper development of bones. A dark-colored skin under normal conditions protects the individual from deleterious effects of ultraviolet light, but still allows some vitamin D to penetrate the skin. This allows for proper bone formation. An ice age, by contrast, is characterized by reduced sunlight and also many sunless days. The ability of dark skin to shield sunlight becomes a disadvantage under these conditions as reduced supply of vitamin D is also shielded out. In addition, people in extremely cold environments are likely to cover their bodies from head to foot in thick clothing of one sort or another. This too reduces the skin's exposure to vitamin D. In such situations, dark-colored people are more likely to suffer the debilitating effects of vitamin D deficiency. This causes osteomalacia in adults and rickets in children. The affected individual's bones become prone to fracture and deformities. This is exactly what was observed among the early skeletons found in Europe. For the albinos among these early black migrants, their situation would have been markedly different. It is well known that albinism is present in small numbers among all of the world's populations. The white and skin color is usually a disadvantage in hot climate, but is not a disadvantage in cold climate. Therefore, while vitamin D deficiency would have reduced the life expectancy of the early dark-skinned Europeans, it would not have caused problems for the few albinos among them. They would have therefore had normal life expectancies. The longer one lives, the more descendants one is more likely to produce on average. Over thousands of years of extreme climatic pressure, the albinos would gradually have become the majority in Europe. The range of skin shades among albinos, the hair colors, and also the eye colors correspond well with those of modern Europeans. As Dr. Charles Finch, author of the impressive book on human origins and prehistory, explains, thus a mutation deleterious in one environment confers a distinct advantage in another, and swiftly propagates for that reason. Summing up his analysis, Dr. Finch proposes that the H. sapiens sapiens population that survived the last glaciation was largely a group of albinoids, who were better adapted to the ecology than their darker relatives who had originally colonized the area. These latter were gradually replaced by albinoids, though small groups of African aboriginal types long persisted on the North Atlantic seaboard because of the availability of vitamin D-rich saltwater fish. Other than white skin color, the other traits associated with Caucasians, such as lank hair and narrow facial features, also evolved to suit the environment. Dr. Finch explained how this worked. 85% of the heat loss from the human body comes from the head and face. In equatorial Africa, the kinky and particularly the peppercorn hair of the early human types would expose more of the scalp to the atmosphere and so promote heat loss. The typical negroid broad nose and flaring nostrils would enhance the loss of moisture, and therefore heat, during respiration. The thick negroid lips would increase the surface area of the face and further facilitate heat loss. Bodily leanness, so characteristic of East African Nilotic types, would also promote heat loss. Among Caucasians of the frigid north, by contrast, body heat would have to be conserved. The characteristic Caucasian narrow nose and thin lips by reducing surface area would help preserve heat. The narrowed nostrils would also aid in warming inspired air. Caucasian straight hair falling down on the back of the neck would help preserve heat in the head and neck region. The tendency in the male Caucasian to more profuse body hair may have also been an aid to heat preservation on the hunt away from his campfires. We have already noted that hominids, like other warm-blooded animals, are regulated by the effects of Gloger's Law, which states that the closer an animal is to the equator, the darker his coat. The closer to the Arctic Circle, the whiter his coat. The polar bear, the Arctic fox, and the snowshoe rabbits are all examples of winterized white-coated Arctic animals who illustrate Gloger's Law. The Caucasian phenotype among H. sapiens sapiens also follows it. The Mongolian peoples of Asia, the Chinese, Japanese, Malaysian, etc., probably emerged as some mixture of black and white. The similarity in features of the Mongolian peoples to some of the Negroes of southern Africa, the so-called Bushman or Hottentot type, is somewhat striking. Both groups are scant of body hair, short in stature, and have epicanthic folds over their eyes, perhaps the most well-known stereotype of the Mongolian face. The Japanese scholar Dr. Nobuo Takano developed a theory that the South African type of the Negro crossbred with Europeans to produce the Mongolian type. Since Bushmen or Hottentots were all over prehistoric Europe, as attested to by the Argonation art, it is likely that they were also in Asia. The admixture with the newly emerged Caucasian lightened the color of the population and straightened their hair. This must have taken place within the last 20,000 years. Some of these peoples, a few thousand years later, migrated from Asia to America across the Bering Strait. They became the first humans, inhabitants of North, South, and Central America, the Native Americans. Thus, the native peoples of the Americas and the Mongolians are ethnically related. Everywhere else on the planet where there were no Caucasians or Mongolians, the populations remained purely Negro. This was the case with the prehistoric Southern Asia, Western Asia, Australasia, as well as Africa. Furthermore, remnants of these early Negro populations are still around today in Asia and Australasia. Alluding to the wide distribution of the blacks in the prehistoric times, Professor Chancellor Williams of Howard University notes that this fact alone indicates the great tasks of the future scholarship on the real history of the race. How do we explain such a large population of blacks in southern China, powerful enough to form a kingdom of their own? Or the black people of Formosa, Australia, the Malay Peninsula, Indochina, the Andaman, and numerous other islands. The heavy concentration of Africans in India opens still another field for investigation. The African populations in Palestine, Arabia, and Mesopotamia, i.e. Iraq, are better known, although the many centuries of black rule over Palestine, South Arabia, and in Mesopotamia should be studied and elaborated in more detail. All this will call for a new type of scholarship, a scholarship without any other mission than the discovery of truth. There have been many objections to the data presented above. In the Western world, many people are brought up on the Genesis account of human origins from the Good Book. Even today, the Bible story continues to feed the common sense idea that humanity evolved in the Middle East, which was, of course, where the fabled Garden of Eden was supposedly located. Moreover, ideas taken from the Book of Genesis, such as the Semitic race and the Hamitic race, continues to inform modern linguistics. In 1650, the Irish cleric Archbishop James Usher declared that the world was created in 4004 BC, basing his conclusion on a study of the Holy Bible. A few years later, Dr. John Lightfoot, one-time Vice Chancellor of Cambridge University, offered a greater precision. He suggested that the creation took place on 23rd October 4004 BC at 9 a.m. Of greater importance are the objections of a school of anthropological thought called polycentrism. The school, while disagreeing with each other over the particulars, agree that the human race has many different origins, not just one. In the 19th century, there were scholars who claimed that the Africans evolved from the gorilla, the Europeans from the chimpanzee, and the Mongolians from the orangutan. This nonsense convinced no one, not even racists, and it was back to the drawing board. In 1930s, Franz Wittenrich, himself a victim of racism, proposed a more sophisticated dressing up of the 19th century ideology. A generation later, his student, Professor Carlton Kuhn, was able to win respectability for Wittenrich's idea. Professor Milford H. Wolpoff of the University of Michigan repackaged Kuhn's ideas into a concept called multi-regional evolution. This theory states that the different peoples of the world, such as Africans, East Asians, Europeans, Austronesians, i.e. black people of Asia and Australia, Mongolians, etc., each evolved separately from different man-like apes. From this, it follows that the racial differences between peoples are larger than they may at first appear because each race evolved a separate evolution. To illustrate Professor Wolpoff's ideas, it is instructive to take the example of the evolution of Europeans. It has been pointed out that some Homo erectus left Africa at least 500,000 years ago and wandered all over the globe. In Europe, some of these evolved into Swanscombe man in England and Steinheim man in Germany, both around 300,000 years ago. These types evolved into Neanderthal man around 80,000 years ago, and this type, it was argued, evolved into the modern European. In this way, Wolpoff and his followers can teach that Europeans are not descended from anatomically modern Africans, but from the Neanderthal man. There are, however, serious problems with this hypothesis. Firstly, the distribution of early Homo sapiens remains found across the world show that there are no remains of Caucasians comparable to 195,000 years old. In fact, the oldest known Caucasian skeletons, giving the most generous dates, are only 20,000 years old. Even in Europe, there are older remains going back 39,000 years, but these are of Negroes, not Caucasians. Secondly, African Homo sapiens emerging at least 195,000 years ago is older than Europe's Neanderthal man, emerging only 80,000 years ago. There have been recent attempts to reclassify Swanscombe man and Steinheim man as Neanderthals. We believe that this misinformation, designed to fool the uninitiated into believing that the Neanderthals are much older than modern humanity, when in fact they are younger. Finally, the University of Munich have produced research that has ended the pretensions of the Wolpoff School. A Washington Post staff writer usefully presented this data as follows. Neanderthals, the brawny enigmas who mysteriously disappeared 30,000 years ago after coexisting with modern humans in Europe for tens of thousands of years, were not close relatives or even ancestral forms of existing people, a new study has found. Instead, unprecedented DNA tests on a famous Neanderthal skeleton indicate that the creatures were almost certainly a separate species that contributed little, and probably nothing, to the present human gene pool. The finding, by veteran ancient DNA research savant Pabo of Munich and colleagues, could help bring down the curtain in one of the longest-running and feud-prone disputes in anthropology. Whether Neanderthals disappeared after nearly 300,000 years because they evolved gradually into modern humans, or whether they were abruptly superseded by an evolutionary upstart that left Africa only a few dozen millennia ago and from which all people now alive are descended. The article ends with the following data. Although the recent out-of-Africa hypothesis is now the predominant theory among experts, the debate will continue, and Pabo's lab is looking for another DNA sequences. Meanwhile, DNA specialist Thomas Linhall of Britain's Imperial Cancer Research Fund observes in a companion article in Cell. The present recovery represents a landmark discovery which is arguably the greatest achievement so far in the field of ancient DNA research. Early human culture. The oldest known human culture developed in Katanda, a region in the northeastern Zaire, now Congo. Allison Brooks of George Washington University and John Yellen of National Science Foundation made the discovery in 1988. From the site, they recovered a finely wrought series of harpoon points, all elaborately polished and barbed. Also uncovered was a tool, equally well-crafted, believed to be a dagger. The discovery suggested that the existence of an early aquatic or fishing-based culture. The Katanda people organize annual fishing expeditions during the rainy seasons. They call it catfish. What's exciting is that we're seeing strategic planning for subsistence by people who lived so long ago, says Brooks. Humans in Africa invented sophisticated tool technologies long before the European counterparts, who have often been credited with initiating modern culture. Initially, Brooks and Yellen dated the artifacts to 70,000 years old. Subsequently, they revised the dating of the Katanda culture to 90,000 years old. Early humanity made other significant advances that have come to light. In 1964, a hematite mine was found in Swaziland, or Bamvu Ridge, in the Nguena mountain range. An iron mining company, quite by accident, first made the discovery. Professor Raymond Dart, a scholar at the University of Witwatersrand in Johannesburg, made a scholarly study of the site. His team discovered a large cache of ancient mining tools as well as tunnels and adits. This suggested that the ancients of the region were engaged in systematic mining. In time, 300,000 artifacts were recovered, including thousands of stone main mining tools. Adrian Boucher, one of the archaeologists on site, dated the mine to a staggering 43,200 years old, within an error range of plus or minus 1,600 years. The ancient miners dug for a metal called specularite. This is a type of hematite, an iron-containing ore. Specularite comes in two distinct colors, red and black. Used as a cosmetic and body dye, it may have also been used in funeral rituals. Dr. Raymond Dart is associated with another important discovery. In 1930, his archaeological team discovered a manganese mine at Chawa in Zambia. They found thousands of ancient manganese tools such as axes, chisels, choppers, grindstones, hammers, and wedges. The Chawa mine was dated at 28,000 years old. The manganese was probably used as cosmetic because of the blackish color of its ore. It was also used for tool making. The Ishango bone is a tool handle with notches carved into it. Jean de Hanslin, a Belgian archaeologist of Royal Institute of the Natural Sciences, unearthed it in the late 1950s. He excavated in the Ishango region of Zaire, now called Congo, near Lake Edward. The bone tool was originally thought to have been over 8,000 years old, but a more sensitive recent dating has given dates of 25,000 years old. On the tool are three rows of notches, two of which add up to 60. The number patterns represented by the notches are of great interest. Professor Claudia Zavlosky, an American mathematician, and more recently Dr. Charles Finch, have made independent studies of them. Row 1 shows three notches carved next to 6, 4 carved next to 8, 10 carved next to 2 fives, and finally a 7. The 3 and 6, 4 and 8, and 10 and 5 is believed to represent the process of doubling, or 2n. Row 2 shows 11 notches carved next to 21 notches and 19 notches carved next to 9 notches. This is thought to represent 10 plus 1, 20 plus 1, 20 minus 1, and 10 minus 1. Finally, row 3 shows 11 notches, 13 notches, 17 notches, and 19 notches. 11, 13, 17, and 19 are the prime numbers between 10 and 20. A prime number can only be divided by itself and by 1 to produce a whole number. The early mathematicians behind the Ishango bone therefore understood doubling, or 2n addition, subtraction, and prime numbers. Also, two of the rows add up to 60. Row 2 consists of 11 plus 21 plus 19 plus 9 equals 60. And row 3 consists of 11 plus 13 plus 17 plus 19 equals 60. Dr. Finch believes that this represents an understanding of base 60, which is, incidentally, the mathematical concept on which modern clocks and watches are based. For example, on a modern clock, 60 seconds equals 1 minute, and 60 minutes equals 1 hour. Finally, the centrality of numbers 10 and 20 for the calculations in row 2 and 3 suggests an early understanding of base 10, the basis of the decimal system of counting. For example, on a modern decimal ruler, 10 millimeters equals 1 centimeter, and 10 decimeters equals 1 meter. Ishango is just 4 miles from Katanda, the site of the old harpoon-making culture. Moreover, Jean de Hanslin discovered a cache of harpoon heads in Ishango, as well as the Ishango bone. De Hanslin believed that the harpoon-making culture diffused northward to the Nile Valley region from Ishango. In his own words, from Central Africa, the harpoon style seems to have spread northward. At Khartoum, near the Upper Nile in the Sudan, is a site that was occupied considerably later than Ishango. The harpoon points found show a diversity of styles. Other harpoons have the notches that seem to have been invented first at Ishango, near Khartoum, and a Shashaneb in Neolithic site that contains harpoon points bearing the imprint of Ishango ancestry. From here, the Ishango technique moved westwards along the southern border of the Sahara. The technology also seems to have followed a secondary branch northward from Khartoum along the Nile Valley to Nagata in Egypt. Other Egyptian harpoons show the influence of Near Eastern Natufian culture, i.e. the prehistoric Negro culture of Palestine, and the Fayum in Egypt technique, which is closely related to it. In 1980, Professor Charles Nelson, an anthropologist at the University of Massachusetts, announced an important find in the New York Times. Evidence had come to light of the domestication of cattle in Kenya 15,000 years ago. Dr. Nelson's team found teeth and cattle bones spread over a limited area, suggesting that the animals were not wild. Had cattle been wild, the remains would have been more widely distributed over a larger area. Furthermore, evidence suggests that tsetse flies would have killed off any wild cattle. The highland regions where the cattle bones were discovered were generally free of flies, thus protecting them from the menace. Professor Nelson discovered the cattle bones at three sites in Lukinia Hill District of the Kenyan Highlands. The region was approximately 25 miles from Nairobi. The first known advances in agriculture took place before 12,000 years ago. Professor Fred Wendorf and his colleagues discovered that Africans were the first to grow crops. In the floodplains of the Nile, now part of Egypt's western desert, the people of Wadi Kumbania cultivated crops of barley, capers, chickpeas, dates, legumes, lentils, and wheat. Their ancient tools were also recovered. There were grindstones, milling stones, cutting blades, hide scrapers, engraving burins, and mortars and pestles. The level of the Nile 12,000 years ago was higher than it is now. Each year during the summer, the Nile flooded, depositing rich silt into the Wadi Kumbania region. As the waters receded in late August and September, catfish were left stranded in the ponds that were formed by the depressions. Since ash and charcoal were also uncovered, it seems that the ancients smoked the fish. As the fish stocks were depleted, the people took the opportunity to plant crops on the silt. After the planting, it seems the hunter-gathering was the main activity, judging from the recovered bones. They hunted wild cattle, hard beasts, and sometimes hippos. When December or January arrived, this was the time for the harvest. The cereals were ground to make flour, and the harvest gazelles became the main source of sustenance. Also hunted were geese, ducks, and wild game. By the time of summer, the Nile would flood again. The annual cycle was thus repeated. Bayard Webster, in an article originally from the New York Times, explained Professor Nelson's view on the significance of these two important archaeological discoveries, agriculture and animal husbandry. Such findings suggest that many of the elements necessary for development of civilization, agriculture and animal husbandry, and their accompanying technologies may have originated in surrounding areas and were exported to the Middle East through trade and cultural diffusion of information and ideas. The next major development in culture concerns a mummy found in the Acacus Mountains of southwestern Libya. 40 years ago, a mummified infant was found under the Uin Mahujiak rock shelter. The infant was buried in the fetal position and was mummified using a very sophisticated technique that must have taken hundreds of years to evolve. The technique predates the earliest mummies known in ancient Egypt by at least 1,000 years. Carbon dating is controversial, but the mummy may date from 7,438 BC at the earliest to 3500 BC at the latest. Dr. Savino de Lernia of University of Rome has taken an interest in the mummy and also the culture that produced it. He believes that a widespread culture existed across a large part of Africa that encompassed the regions now designated as Mali, Niger, Chad, Sudan, Algeria, Libya, and Egypt before this vast area became a desert. The rock art, for example, depicts elephants, giraffes, lions, crocodiles, and hippopotami. Many of these animals can only survive in the savanna regions. Some of the earliest pottery associated with this culture dates back to around 7000 BC. In this widespread culture, cattle had a religious and ritualistic significance. There were circular temples built where cattle were sacrificed. Moreover, cattle appear in up to 50% of the rock art. There were also religious rituals involving humans wearing jackal-headed masks depicted in the rock art. Also, humans were typically buried in the fetal position. Initially, Italian archaeologists believed this culture was unique to Libya, but French archaeologists showed a similar culture existed in Niger 500 miles to the south. Dr. Joanne Fletcher, the noteworthy English Egyptologist, believes that the mummification techniques of this culture informed later Egyptian mummification. She further believes that its cattle cult informed Egyptian religious ideas of a later period. Finally, she believes that its jackal's mask rituals informed the Egyptian concept of Anubis, the god of embalming, depicted in Egyptian art as a jackal. Moreover, there is archaeological evidence that Yuan Muhujia decorated pottery later appeared in the southern Nile Valley region. Dr. D. Lernia suggests that the Yuan Muhujia people migrated to the Nile Valley, where the region became a desert. Also, they became an integral part of the ancient Egyptian culture. Dr. Fletcher summarized the importance of these findings thus: I find it quite extraordinary that the central Saharan civilization shows all the features we generally associate with later Egyptian pharaonic culture, and mummification is a prime example. There are definite links between the two cultures. The construction of the Great Sphinx of Giza in northern Egypt represents another major cultural advance, one of the grandest showpieces of early African technology. This colossus was fashioned with the head of a man combined with the body of a lion. At first, the builders carved only the head and the forepart. At a later date, the builders sculpted the body, in particular the hind part. The builders also carved out a rectangular ditch around the body. In this process, tons of limestone were quarried and removed. A key and important question raised by this monument was, how old is it? In October 1991, Professor Robert Schuck, a geologist from Boston University, demonstrated that the Sphinx was sculpted between 7000 BC and 5000 BC, dates that he considered conservative. He arrived at this conclusion by checking the patterns of rainwear on the body of the statue. Egypt is a dry country where there has been no significant rainfall for thousands of years. The Sphinx, however, is partly disfigured by rainwear. Dr. Schuck concluded that the rain damage must have occurred many thousands of years ago when Egypt was a wet country. With the help of the geophysicist Thomas Dobecki, Professor Schuck was able to arrive at solid but conservative dates for the construction of the building. The reaction to this data in Egyptological circles, however, was not encouraging. In the International Herald Tribune of 25 October 1991, we read the following. The research findings were announced Wednesday at the annual meeting of the Geological Society of America in San Diego. They immediately drew fire from Mark Lenner, an Egyptologist at University of Chicago who is leading expert on the Sphinx. Even today, Professor Lerner's emotional outburst has become the typical response to this data by Egyptologists, although no reliable counter-evidence has ever been offered by them to challenge Professor Schuck's finding. Dr. Schuck's dating therefore stands unchallenged. Baron D. V. Denon, a French traveler, made a famous first-hand sketch of the statue in 1798 AD. He also commented on it. The character is African. The lips are thick. Art must have been at a high pitch when this monument was executed. African civilization, the oldest in the world, was firmly established with the construction of this monument at least 7,000 years ago. Civilization had to wait another 1,000 years to emerge in Asia and 4,000 years to emerge in mainland Europe. Mr. Peter Eckler, an American publisher, beautifully summarized the importance of this sculptural masterpiece. In 1890, he issued an English-language translation of the Ruins or Meditations on the Revolutions of Empires and the Law of Nature by Count de Volney, one of the glories of the Enlightenment literature. In the publisher's preface, Mr. Eckler declared that We are in reality indebted to the ancient Ethiopians, to the fervent imagination of the persecuted and despised Negro, for the various religious systems now, so highly revered by the different branches of both the Semitic and Aryan races. This fact, which is so frequently referred to in Mr. Volney's writings, may even suggest a solution to the secret so long concealed beneath the flat nose, thick lips, and Negro features of Egyptian Sphinx. Count de Volney himself wrote a fine summary of the stages that humankind passed through on the long road from savagery to civilization. We give him the last word on this topic. Formed naked in body and mind, man at first found himself thrown, as it were by chance, on a rough and savage land, an orphan, abandoned by the unknown power which has produced him. Like to the other animals, without experience of the past, without foresight of the future, he wandered in the bosom of the forest, guided only and governed by affections of his nature. By the pain of hunger, he was led to seek food and provide for her subsistence. By the inclemency of the air, he was urged to cover his body, and he made him clothes. By the attraction of a powerful pleasure, he approached a being like himself, and he perpetuated his kind. Thus the impressions which he received from every object, awakening his faculties, developed by degrees his understanding, and began to instruct his profound ignorance. His once excited industry, dangers formed his courage. He learned to distinguish useful from noxious plants, to combat the elements, to seize his prey, to defend his life, and thus he alleviated his miseries. Thus self-love, aversion to pain, the desire of happiness, were the simple and powerful excitements which drew man from the savage and barbarous conditions in which nature had placed him. Wandering in the woods and on the banks of the rivers in pursuit of game and fish, the first men, beset with dangers, assailed by enemies, tormented by hunger, by reptiles, by ravenous beasts, felt their own individual weakness, and urged by a common need of safety and reciprocal sentiment of like evils, they united their resources and their strength, and when one incurred a danger, many aided and succored him. When one wanted sustenance, another shared his food with them. Thus men associated to secure their existence, to augment their powers, to protect their enjoyments, and self-love thus became the principle of society. And men, aiding one another, seized the nimble goat, the timid sheep, the tamed and patient camel, the fierce bull, and the impetuous horse. When, therefore, men could pass long days in leisure and in communication of their thoughts, they began to contemplate the earth, the heavens, and their own existence. As objects of curiosity and reflection, they remarked the course of the seasons, the action of the elements, the properties of fruits and plants, and applied their thoughts to the multiplication of their enjoyments. And in some countries, having observed that certain seeds contain a wholesome nourishment in a small volume, convenient for transportation and preservation, they imitated the process of nature. They confided to the earth rice, barley, and corn, which multiplied to the full measure of their hope. And having found the means of obtaining within a small compass and without removal, plentiful sustenance and durable stores, they established themselves in fixed habitations, they built houses, villages, and towns, and formed societies and nations.